I'm Lynn Scherr, and I'd like to invite you to join me on an amazing adventure. We're going to travel across the country, exploring an America you probably never knew existed. Most tourist maps highlight our forefathers at battlefields and ballparks and state houses. And sometimes it seems that every pigeon in America has the statue of a man to roost on. Well, we'll be visiting places where women made history, following in our four mothers' footsteps to see where they lived or created or soared or rebelled, usually against incredible odds. Along the way, you're going to meet some extraordinary women, athletes and artists, politicians and pioneers, as we tour the actual sites that tell their stories. The museum in Texas honoring our greatest female athlete. The land in New Mexico that inspired a superb artist.
The sky is different, the stars are different, the wind is different.
The planetarium in New Hampshire commemorating the school teacher who reached for the stars.
3, 2, 1.
And the courtroom in New York where one woman's principled stand gave us new rights. There's much, much more. And to help celebrate the lives of those who fashioned our past, four of today's most accomplished women. U.S. Olympic gold medalist and ABC sports commentator Donna DeVerona on Athletes and Adventurers. The star of TV's Days and Nights of Molly Dodd, Blair Brown, on Artists and Performers. Our first African-American female astronaut, Dr. Mae Jemison, on Groundbreakers and Heroes. And our special guest, First Lady Hillary Rodham Clinton, on Suffragists and Stateswomen. So settle in, while I buckle up, for a most unusual journey. We've got lots of surprises, plenty of fun, and one promise. For this trip, you won't have to identify any of those statues of generals on horseback. And you definitely won't be seeing any of those road signs that say, George Washington slept here. Beaumont, Texas, hometown of the Babe, not Babe Ruth, but the Babe Didrikson Zaharias Museum, dedicated to the greatest sportswoman of this century. Babe grew up here in Beaumont in the 1920s, at a time when athletic little girls were called tomboys. She practiced hurdles by jumping over neighbors' hedges, dominated the local basketball scene. And here you can see a virtual treasury of her victories throughout her life. These are the medals she won at the 1932 Olympics in Los Angeles. 2 gold, 1 silver. Another Olympian, who won her 2 gold medals in swimming at the 1964 Games, grew up wanting to be just like Babe. ABC sportscaster Donna DeVerona.
Lynn, I admire not only Babe's fantastic athletic talents, but her commitment to change the landscape of women's sports. And she was so focused. I knew exactly what I wanted to be when I grew up, she said. My goal was to be the greatest athlete that ever lived. In 1950, she was named the outstanding woman athlete of the half century. Nearly 50 years later, no one has taken that title away. Think of Babe as the Michael Jordan of her day, a superstar with a body so splendid, according to her gym teacher, her muscles flowed when she walked. She was the Texas Tornado, the great god Babe.
The greatest female athlete, Babe Didrikson. The incredible Texas tomboy never claimed to have the prettiest legs, just the fastest. Babe's record is really prodigious. In basketball and track, she was in a class by herself. Only because she was declared ineligible did she miss becoming our national tennis champion. And at baseball, she could and did outplay most men. Watch this slow-motion study of a Didrikson pitch.
Her parents, who named her Mildred, started calling her Babe as a child. But with the cocky showmanship that fed her celebrity, she always claimed her nickname came from the Yankee great, guess who? Babe Ruth, for her phenomenal power as a home run hitter. She even pitched once to Joe DiMaggio in an exhibition game and struck him out. "I've competed against boys as long as I can remember," she explained. "If a girl wants to become an athlete and do some winning, that's what she has to do, play against the boys, get smashed around. I've done some smashing of my own."
She came and she wanted to be a part of our sports in our high school. The kids that were practicing football, well, they'd get interrupted by the Babe because she'd want to be the quarterback and call the plays and call the shots, and they would do the same thing with basketball. She'd get on the court and here we go. Babe's a team and all the others are players.
At the 1932 Olympics, Babe was a one-woman track team, smashing records with her gold medal victories in hurdles and the javelin throw. Her second place silver in the high jump tied the world record.
Do you have any idea how hard it is to win even one Olympic gold medal?
But for all her accomplishments, Babe's real passion was golf. And this was her personal driver. You think you get distance off the tee? Well, Babe was so powerful, she could drive the ball more than 300 yards.
She explained it with a wisecrack. "When I really want to bust one, I just loosen my girdle and let her fly." Babe revolutionized the game, turning a polite ladies' dance into an aggressive display of force. She was the first woman to score consistently in the 60s, the first American woman to win the British Women's Amateur Championship. A fierce competitor, she once won 17 amateur golf tournaments in a row. Her lifetime total was a staggering 82 victories. Her lasting legacy is the LPGA, the Ladies Professional Golf Association, which she helped found in 1948 to get female golfers more money and more prestige.
But pressure golf is no new business to the Babe. She was Western Open queen back in 1940, and today sees her at the peak of her form. There you are, as simple as that. Five up at the end of 27 holes, and needing only this putt to bag the crown by a final margin of seven up with five to play. Babe, it looks like you've got everything.
Babe seemed invincible. Even when she was diagnosed with colon cancer, she spoke out candidly to lessen public fears about the disease. After surgery, while in terrible pain, she made a heroic comeback, winning five golf tournaments in 1954. At her record-breaking 12-stroke U.S. Open victory, she valiantly acknowledged her struggle.
I laid in the bed and I said, "Please, God, let me play again." And he answered my prayer. And I want to thank God for letting me win again. It's really wonderful.
Finally, even she was defeated. Babe Didrikson Zaharias was only 45 when she died of cancer in 1956. But her desire to win has always motivated me, Lynn. She set the standard.
As they said back then, what a gal. But Beaumont, Texas isn't the only place to find women whose physical prowess put them on the map. Rugged Mount Blackburn in Alaska is a towering monument to Dora Keene, the first woman and first recorded person to climb its magnificent peaks. In Dearborn, Michigan, a monument points out that Jeanette Picard floated to her record altitude, more than 10 miles high, in a balloon that took off nearby. Go to Atchison, Kansas to see the second-story bedroom where Amelia Earhart was born in 1897. The world's most famous female pilot, known as Lady Lindy, disappeared in 1937 during a round-the-world flight. In Sweetwater, Texas, Earhart's friend, Jacqueline Cochran, ran the first and only all-woman military flying school during World War II. Her women's Air Force service pilots, the WASPs, flew everything but combat missions, and they always wore lipstick with their jumpsuits. But for sheer grit and enterprise, we direct you to Niagara Falls and a determined schoolteacher named Annie Edson Taylor. In 1901, she climbed into a barrel and plunged over the falls, the first person to survive. You can see her barrel at the museum here. As you can see, women challenge the odds all over the United States. So perhaps it won't surprise you to find one of our most illustrious Wild West stars just outside Dayton, Ohio. The town is Greenville. And this is the statue of the woman born Phoebe Ann Mosey. You know her better as Annie Oakley, the spunky sharpshooter who captivated the nation by doing just about anything a man could do better. You can see her birthplace on what was once a farm, her 16-gauge double-barreled shotgun, coins she shot in midair, and the traveling trunk that took her all over the world. Her frontier spirit also won over Donna DeVerona.
I think it was Annie Oakley's pluck that impressed me, and it arose out of a family need. She was barely 8 years old when she took her late father's rifle, it was bigger than she was, to hunt squirrels and quail for the dinner table. Later, she sold what she shot and trapped to help pay her mother's mortgage. Annie's aim was so accurate that as a young woman, she defeated the well-known sharpshooter Frank Butler in a clay pigeon match. In awe and in love, he married her. Now a team, they took their act onto the variety stage and to Buffalo Bill Cody's immensely popular Wild West show. That was in 1885, and that's where Annie, a tiny 5 feet tall and just over 100 pounds, really sparkled. She hit bullseye after bullseye, and she did it on horseback, between her legs, and even backwards.
She shot at all kinds of targets, glass balls, clay pigeons. It was a phenomenal career. Everyone recognized her remarkable skill, amazing talent for a woman, which people just found almost impossible to believe that a woman could do what she did.
Annie's performance was so electrifying. Chief Sitting Bull, who had annihilated Custer at Little Bighorn, sought her out and adopted her as his daughter. He gave Annie a Sioux name, Wantania Cecilia, Little Sure Shot. Annie's shooting displays never glorified violence. They were sporting events and showbiz in the spirit of the freewheeling West. She was a marvelous athlete whose crowd-pleasing marksmanship earned her the highest salary of all the performers. And she brought other women into the arena, making sure they were hired at proper wages.
Equal pay for equal work was her goal. And she stood by that all her life.
Annie set her sights on what really counted.
She said, aim at a high mark and you will hit it. No, not the first time, maybe not the second, and maybe not the third, but keep on aiming and keep on shooting, for only practice will make you perfect. Finally, you'll hit the bullseye of success.
Long before it was fashionable, Annie Oakley encouraged regular outdoor activity, saying, I think that sport and healthful exercise make women better, healthier, and happier. Imagine, we thought our generation came up with that idea.
All these adventures sound so up-to-date, so much to teach us. And what these women did for our bodies, others did for our souls. I'm off to New Mexico now to see the land that inspired one of our most wondrous artists. Want to see something gorgeous? Come on along. You know, I never feel at home in the East like I do out here. I feel like myself, and I like it. One perfect day after another. This is the magical country for me. Those aren't my words, although I share the sentiment. They were written by the artist, Georgia O'Keeffe, describing her long love affair with the dazzling beauty of New Mexico. She visited for the first time in 1929, and the stark landscape and the brilliant light so enchanted her, she painted and lived here off and on for the rest of her life. In 1945, she bought this adobe house in the remote village of Abiquiu. She said, that wall with the door in it was something I had to have. She would capture it on canvas many times. Georgia O'Keeffe called this land the Far Away, and anyone who's ever been here understands why. That includes TV and stage star Blair Brown.
I love Georgia O'Keeffe's work, especially the later years when New Mexico so permeated her art. She actually got her start in New York City in 1916 when a mutual friend showed some of her work to the famed photographer Alfred Stieglitz. He was awestruck. At last, he reportedly said, a woman on paper. That led to a show at his New York gallery and marriage in 1924. Together, O'Keeffe and Stieglitz led the modern art world.
I can see shapes. It's as if my mind creates shapes that I don't know about.
When Stieglitz died, O'Keeffe, who had spent long and agonizing periods away from him in her beloved New Mexico, came out west to stay. Juan Hamilton was her constant companion in her later years.
She didn't like anybody around when she was working. So she was able to find out in the West the solitude, the isolation, and the vastness, the openness that she had romanticized as a child, and she fit into it very well.
You can recognize so many of her surroundings in her paintings. The sun-bleached bones of the desert, the rich tradition of the church, the lyrical patterns of the clouds as seen from an airplane. The simple elegance of a flower was magnified by her imagination. "I'll paint what I see," she once wrote, "but I'll paint it big. I will make even busy New Yorkers take time to see what I see of flowers."
It just amused me, the idea of making them look at, getting them to see what I saw.
I think that people not only get a sense of who Georgia O'Keeffe was through looking at her paintings, but they might even get a better sense of who they are.
O'Keeffe's powerful style defined not only her art, but the way she dressed and lived. Walking through this house with its smooth surfaces and carefully arranged objects is like stepping into one of her paintings. Underneath that austere image lurked a mischievous nature, especially when someone dared to intrude on her sanctuary here in Abiquiu.
A woman came up to the gate outside the studio here, and O'Keeffe heard the dogs barking. She went out and said, "Can I help you?" And the woman said, "Yes, I came to see you." And O'Keeffe said, "Well, what can I do for you?" And she said, "Well, I just wanted to see you." And O'Keeffe said, "Well, front, side, and rear," and walked away, standing in those three positions.
When I got to New Mexico, that was mine. As soon as I saw it, that was my country. I'd never seen anything like it before, but it fitted to me exactly.
Like something that's in the air, it's just different. The sky is different, the stars are different, the wind is different. I shouldn't say too much about this because other people may get interested and I don't want them interested.
It is a sad irony that this woman who so loved nature, this worshiper of light and shapes and colors, would go blind just before she died in 1986 at age 98. "When I think of death," she wrote, "I only regret that I will not be able to see this beautiful country anymore, unless the Indians are right and my spirit will walk here after I'm gone." Today, her spirit remains in her paintings and in New Mexico, her special place.
You can feel it in every room of this house. As a matter of fact, many of America's most prominent artists were shaped by their surroundings, places you too can visit. Start nearby in Colorado Springs, Colorado, where English professor Catherine Lee Bates stood atop Pike's Peak one day in 1893. She turned the amber waves of grain and purple mountain majesties into the poem that became America the Beautiful, our unofficial national anthem. Willa Cather set her Pulitzer Prize-winning novels in the prairies near her hometown, Red Cloud, Nebraska. "My deepest feelings were rooted in this country," she wrote. "Whenever I crossed the Missouri River coming into Nebraska, the very smell of the soil tore me to pieces." Louisa May Alcott wrote her classic, Little Women, on a tiny desk in the house in Concord, Massachusetts, where she grew up, modeling the characters on her own family. And Margaret Mitchell drew on the history of her native Atlanta, Georgia, when she wrote the world's all-time bestseller, Gone with the Wind. San Francisco native Isadora Duncan, the mother of modern dance, based her style on the rhythmic movements of the ocean's waves. Her flamboyant life was cut short when her trailing scarf caught in an automobile wheel, breaking her neck. Death has ended the lives of some of our most gifted performers, including the blues singer Bessie Smith. She died in 1937 in a car accident in Tennessee. But this gravestone outside her adopted hometown of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, wasn't erected until 1970, when two of her admirers, including the singer Janis Joplin, raised the money to remember their neglected hero. The greatest blues singer in the world will never stop singing. Another Bessie Smith fan is Blair Brown.
Am I ever? She always makes me cry. She puts a little steel in my backbone. There's a line from a Fats Waller number that Bessie sang where she thumbs her nose at the world. Part of it goes, "There ain't nothing I can do or nothing I can say that folks don't criticize me. But I'm going to do just as I want anyway and don't care if they all despise me."
Bessie Smith lived the words she sang. An imposing presence, she was close to 6 feet tall, who was once denied a job in a chorus line because her skin was too black. She lost her temper often and didn't hesitate to use her fists, either in real life or playing a jilted blues singer on film.
Larry! Come on, now, you gonna move? Yeah. Don't you hit me? Well, now, yeah! Well, look here! Now, wait a minute, Jeff! Grab the woman!
Well, in Bessie's day, a woman in this business, it was a man's world, actually. So a woman had to be very tough in order to survive.
Once in Chattanooga, after a night of drinking and carousing, Bessie punched out a man who was bothering one of her chorus girls. A few hours later, he came back and stabbed her. But Bessie was back on stage singing the next day.
When she sang about love gone bad, well, she certainly could relate to that. She was telling a story, and she could identify with that story.
My man's got a heart like a rocket in the sea. My man's got a heart like a rocket in the sea. My man's got a heart like a rocket.
They called her the Empress of the Blues. And while white people bought her records, she was mostly booked into black theaters. With a voice that never required a microphone, she put on a commanding performance.
She would go into the audience, fix her eyes on one person, and then walk backwards, and they would follow her on stage. And she hypnotized them.
Bessie Smith loved women and men and had affairs with both. She married Jack G in 1923, who helped produce some of her shows. But when he cheated on her and stole money, she sent him packing. Bessie admitted missing him when he was gone. On September 26, 1937, Bessie Smith was killed in an automobile accident on Route 61 south of Memphis. The world of blues had lost its most powerful voice.
Tomorrow, like I see.
Bessie Smith, all these women wrote their own rules. They had to, in a world that rarely encouraged women to follow their dreams. Next, we'll meet even more trailblazers, women who aimed for the stars, and one who actually got there. Their stories begin in New York when we return. Just over 75 years ago, if you'd driven up to this mansion in Irvington, New York, just outside New York City, you'd likely have heard the clinking of fine crystal, the ring of polished silver, and the subdued hum of a glamorous dinner party in progress. This was Villa Loaro, the hub of a bustling social whirl, and it was built not by a Rockefeller, but by our first African-American female millionaire, Madam C.J. Walker. Her neighbors in this rather exclusive enclave were astounded. Impossible, one gasped. No woman of her race could own such a place. How did the child of former slaves amass such a fortune on her own? Well, who better to help us understand than a distinguished groundbreaker herself, the first African-American woman to fly in space, Dr. Mae Jemison.
Lynn, one of the things I most admire about Madam C.J. Walker is that at a time when most women couldn't even get a job, she built a financial empire. Madam C.J. Walker was born Sarah Breedlove, and she was a self-made success. "I got my start by giving myself a start," she said. And then she stretched out her hand to other women. In 1912, she told her life story. "I am a woman who came from the cotton fields of the South. I was promoted from there to the washtub. Then I was promoted to the cook kitchen. And from there, I promoted myself into the business of manufacturing hair goods and preparations. I have built my own factory on my own ground." That ground was in Indianapolis, Indiana, then a major center of commerce with a thriving black business community. It all began when she was a washerwoman, ashamed and frustrated because her hair was falling out. One night, she had a dream. Her great-great-granddaughter, Alilia Bundles, heard what happened.
Madam Walker said, "A big African man came to me in a dream and told me what to mix up for my hair. I sent to Africa for it and mixed it up and put it on my hair, and my hair began to grow." Now, that was part of Madam Walker's myth-making. She was a great myth-maker. Some people say that maybe she had a little help from a pharmacist, but she conveyed to everyone that a big African man had told her what to do, and that helped her sell her products.
The Walker Manufacturing Company included beauty schools, beauty parlors, a swank cosmetic bar where ladies could get anything from hair waves to toenail polish, and traveling saleswomen, more than 1,000 African-American women getting an opportunity to go out into the world and earn a decent living.
She said when she was selling her products, she didn't just want people to buy the products, she wanted them to become successful themselves. She was one of the earliest advocates of women's economic independence.
Madam Walker filled this stately country house with marble, bronze, and ivory. She draped herself with satins and lace, but she never took her prosperity for granted. Listen to what happened here one Christmas, surrounded by friends and family.
Christmas morning, everyone awakened very early, and there was a light snow, and they walked through the property and down toward the river, and then they came back for breakfast. And at breakfast, she had everyone around the table, and they knelt and they prayed. And Madam was praying and saying how she was humbled and how generous God had been to her and how thankful she was.
She liked to point out that she started her business with $1.50. Don't sit down and wait for the opportunities to come, she urged black women. Get up and make them.
Madam Walker ultimately earned the respect of her neighbors here and across the country. And while you wouldn't know it from reading most history books, on this tour of America, heroic women are all over the map. Next time you're in Moingona, Iowa, stroll across the Kate Shelley Bridge, named for the intrepid 15-year-old who, in 1881, made a heroic dash that saved all the passengers of a train that had plummeted into the creek. Kate got a Tiffany Gold Medal for her bravery. Auburn, New York, was the home of Harriet Tubman, former slave turned chief engineer on the Underground Railroad. She led some 300 men, women, and children to freedom. Inscribed on her grave here, "Servant of God, well done." Molly Brown of Denver saved lives too as the unsinkable rower of lifeboat number 6 when the cruise ship Titanic went down. Her lavishly furnished home is testament to the social cachet of heroism. In Tuscumbia, Alabama, visit the birthplace of Helen Keller, the gifted and courageous figure who, though disease took her sight and hearing, devoted her life to others who were blind and deaf. Helen Keller never gave up.
I am not dumb now.
Numerous sites remember the Native American hero, Sacagawea, from her birthplace in Salmon, Idaho, to her statue in Portland, Oregon. She was a literal trailblazer, serving as guide and translator to Lewis and Clark during their expedition west. Sacagawea supporters may have been too enthusiastic. Two states, Wyoming and South Dakota, claim her grave. It was the flat landscape and boundless sky of Nantucket, Massachusetts, that formed our country's first female astronomer, Maria Mitchell. From the roof atop her home, where you can still see her telescope, she learned to scan the heavens so well as a child, she discovered a comet in 1847. Another woman who inherited that New England resolve also reached for the stars, and this planetarium here in Concord, New Hampshire is named for her. Christa McAuliffe was a schoolteacher with a dream far beyond the classroom. She wanted to fly in space to help children understand its importance, and she unwittingly became one of its few casualties. I covered the space program as a reporter, and I remember too well where I was when the Space Shuttle Challenger exploded, trying to explain to a shattered nation why the unthinkable had happened. At the time, Mae Jemison was actively applying to be an astronaut. The accident did not deter her.
I decided to become an astronaut because I've wanted to go into space since childhood. So I understand why Krista McAuliffe set her sights there too. One of her colleagues called her a risk-taker, someone who was not afraid of life. Her mother, Grace Corrigan, says Krista never sat back and just existed. She lived.
She is a groundbreaker. She has been a groundbreaker. And you might even consider her a hero. We consider her a hero because of what she did with her life, not because she lost her life. And she always felt that everyone makes a difference, but she has made a very big difference.
Krista McAuliffe's dream and hope remain an inspiration. It all started with a speech by President Ronald Reagan.
Today I'm directing NASA to begin a search in all of our elementary and secondary schools and to choose as the first citizen passenger in the history of our space program, one of America's finest, a teacher.
Krista McAuliffe picked up an application while at a teacher's meeting in Washington, D.C. When she got home, her husband Steve read the 14-page form and said, "Go for it."
When Krista called and told us about the program, we were thoroughly excited for her. She thought it would be the greatest thing in the world to have this experience. And she felt that the program was going to be a tremendous boon for teachers.
As a historian teaching social studies, I've been very concerned that the social history, the history of the ordinary people, is not in history textbooks. We hear about military and political and economic history. We don't find out what the ordinary person was doing. So, like a woman on the Conestoga wagon pioneering the West, I too would be able to bring back my thoughts and my journal to make that a part of our history.
The announcement came at the White House in July 1985. For the 36-year-old Krista McAuliffe, who had been chosen from nearly 12,000 entrants to become one of 10 finalists, it was a typically humble moment.
It's not often that a teacher is at a loss for words. I know my students wouldn't think so. I've made 9 wonderful friends over the last 2 weeks. And when that shuttle goes, they might be one body. But there's going to be 10 souls that I'm taking with me. Thank you.
Like all of us, the rookie space traveler had to learn shuttle procedures, how to live in weightlessness, and stay fit. She missed her kids, agonized over the separation from her husband, but she never let go of her goal.
She had, of course, been told about all of the things that could really go wrong, and she knew this, but she was also very confident in NASA. I really do not feel that she had any qualms about the safety of the program.
By the time of the launch on that frigid January 28, 1986, Challenger's liftoff had been delayed 4 times. Krista wasn't discouraged. She remained upbeat, leaving the crew quarters one more time. She was taking along her son's stuffed frog, her husband's class ring, a Bob Dylan tape. As a group of visiting school children counted down the liftoff out loud, others held a banner reading, "Go Krista."
I have heard from people all around the world writing and telling me what Krista has meant to them. She made children really want to know more about education. She made them excited about the space program, but using it as a tool for education. And she made people feel good about themselves. So I feel that her mission has thoroughly been completed.
Krista McAuliffe was buried here in Concord. Wife, mother, teacher, pioneer woman, America's first ordinary citizen to venture toward space. She laughed, she loved, she was curious. She tried to protect our spaceship Earth. She taught her children to do the same. And thanks to this living memorial, her children, all of them, can continue to touch the future. All these women are astounding, but stick around if you want to meet my personal hero. She made it possible for me and for all women to be full citizens of this country, and she nearly went to jail in the process. We'll also be joined by our special guest, First Lady Hillary Rodham Clinton. I'm on my way to Rochester, New York. See you there. Woman in America can claim this house in Rochester, New York as her heritage because this was the home of the leader of the first women's movement. In other words, Susan B. Anthony slept here. You may know her only as the face on the $1 coin, and a rather prim profile at that. But Anthony was an eloquent, witty, powerful celebrity who devoted her entire adult life to winning women equal rights, above all, the right to vote. Why, you might ask, was the female half of the population banned from the ballot box? Beats me. But the founding fathers kept that privilege and most others for themselves until Anthony and her colleagues demanded a change. This house was the nerve center of her suffrage organization. And here you can see the gold wire glasses that framed her radical vision of women as partners in democracy. The inkwell that fueled a barrage of letters to congressmen, senators, and presidents. And it was from this house more than a century ago that Susan B. Anthony set out on her gutsiest move ever. To recall that story, we are joined by a distinguished guest with her own long commitment to women, the First Lady, Hillary Rodham Clinton.
Lynn, what a huge debt we owe to the suffragists, above all to Susan B. Anthony. I think what amazes me most is her dedication, her absolute conviction that her cause was correct, even in the face of searing criticism. She used every opportunity to make her point. Once, while lecturing on suffrage in South Dakota in 1890, she was interrupted repeatedly by a drunken fellow making rude comments. When the men in the audience cried, "Put him out," Susan B. Anthony intervened, saying sweetly, "No, gentlemen, he is a product of man's government, and I want you to see what sort you make." You can imagine how people responded when she decided to test the law. It was November 1872, just before a presidential election.
Susan B. Anthony and her three sisters walked up to the local barbershop and registered to vote. They had 14th and 15th Amendments in hand, because they felt that that should have provided for their right to vote. Well, the local newspapers were outraged. They demanded that these women should be prosecuted to the full extent of the law.
A few days later, at 7 a.m., thoughtfully early to avoid a public spectacle, the newly registered Anthony went back to the barbershop and cast the first ballot of her life. She voted for Ulysses S. Grant, Republican candidate for president, and two congressmen. 3 weeks later, Thanksgiving Day, she was arrested.
The U.S. Marshal came to Susan B. Anthony's front door to arrest her. She had him come right into this front parlor, and he was embarrassed. She was a very famous woman, and he was there to arrest her. Well, he stumbled through the arrest, and she would have no part of it. He just said, "Go down to the city hall when you're ready." She said, "No, if you think I'm nothing but a common criminal, you can handcuff me and take me downtown right now." Well, he didn't handcuff her, but he did take her downtown. And, you know, in those days, they didn't have police cars, so they took the streetcar. And when she was asked for her 5-cent fare, she said, "I'm going at the request of the federal government. You can ask this man for my fare."
As the acknowledged ringleader, Susan B. Anthony was indicted and eventually brought to trial.
In this fine old courthouse in nearby Canandaigua, New York, you can still hear the echoes of the case. The United States of America versus Susan B. Anthony. It was a beautiful June day, 1873. In the upstairs courtroom, friends and gawkers filed in. Seated in the jury box, 12 white men. No women allowed.
Anthony's defense attorney called it the first instance in which a woman has been arraigned in a criminal court merely on account of her sex. The judge was not moved. In fact, he had written his decision before hearing the case and directed the jury to find a verdict of guilty.
Susan B. Anthony was incensed. Having been barred from testifying on her own behalf, She was now asked by the court if she had anything to say.
Yes, Your Honor, I have many things to say. For your ordered verdict of guilty, you have trampled underfoot every vital principle of our government. My natural rights, my civil rights, my political rights are all alike ignored. Robbed of the fundamental privilege of citizenship, I am degraded from the status of a citizen to that of a subject. And not only myself individually, but all of my sex are, by Your Honor's verdict, doomed to political subjection under this so-called Republican government.
The judge tried to interrupt her, but she stormed on. And when she stopped, the judge sentenced her to a $100 fine. She replied, "I will never pay $1 of your unjust penalty." And she never did. But in her diary that night, she called her trial the greatest outrage history ever witnessed.
Susan B. Anthony did not live to vote legally. She died at her home in Rochester in 1906. But her last public statement, "Failure is impossible," continued to rally the troops. And the shrewd campaign that followed produced a hardy new breed of female politician. In South Pass City, Wyoming, the first territory to grant women full suffrage, you can visit the two-room cabin of Esther Morris, the first woman to hold political office in the United States. In Argonia, Kansas, tour the home of the nation's first female mayor. Susanna Salter was elected in 1887, learning of her surprise victory while up to her elbows in wash suds on her back stoop. Missoula, Montana, celebrates native daughter Jeanette Rankin, who in 1916 became the first woman elected to the U.S. Congress. Her two widely separated terms were marked by voting her conscience in opposition to both world wars. That distinction is preserved in a giant likeness of Congresswoman Rankin in the U.S. Capitol.
Did you know, Lynn, over on the other side of the Capitol, the first woman elected to the United States Senate was from Arkansas, Hattie Caraway in 1932. But my personal hero is a woman who made political history without ever running for office, Eleanor Roosevelt. In Hyde Park, New York, you can tour the cottage at Valkill, built just for her. But the entire world is a landmark to her social activism. Eleanor Roosevelt's courage in the face of enormous hostility has been a constant source of inspiration to me. Her emergence as a voice for human rights inspired all Americans, above all women, to have our say in public life. And that never could have happened without the most fundamental right of all, the vote. It is hard to believe we have had that right for just 75 years. Harder still to understand how anyone, especially women, could neglect to use that privilege in view of the terrible struggle to win it. So as we celebrate the suffrage anniversary this year, we should not only thank the women who fought to give all Americans the right to vote, but recognize how much it cost, how long it took, and how precious the prize.
It took 72 years, but you can retrace the route quickly today, starting in Seneca Falls, New York, site of the first public convention in the world to focus on women's issues and ask for the right to vote. It led to decades of demonstrations, campaigns, picketing, lobbying, and lecturing. It was, in the words of one suffrage leader, a continuous, seemingly endless chain of activity. Young suffragists who helped forge the last links of that chain were not born when it began. Old suffragists who forged the first links were dead when it ended. Nashville, Tennessee, August 1920. Although there is no official memorial to the breathtaking finale, the story itself is epic. A federal amendment to the Constitution granting the vote to all women had passed both houses of Congress. 35 states had ratified. With just one more needed, suffrage leaders targeted Tennessee. There at the last minute, state legislator Harry Byrne, 24, changed his vote to aye, saying he did it because his mother told him to. The 19th Amendment was law. In honor of the woman who had predicted its inevitability, it was called the Susan B. Anthony Amendment.
I shall not be here to see it, but the 20th century will see as great a change in the position and progress of women in the world as has been accomplished in this century. But it will have ceased to cause comment and will be accepted as a matter of course. Woman and her influence in making and shaping affairs will have to be reckoned with.
I hope you've enjoyed our journey and that discovering our female heritage makes you want to hit the road in search of your own favorite hero. I also hope you agree that while some of these women were shaped by a particular place, and others merely remembered there, each has enriched our lives and deserves her own place on the map. Keep in mind, this is not the end of the trail. Our country is full of landmarks to the wonderful women of our past. You just have to know where to look.